different ways to look at women as protagonists in nonviolent movements and campaigns. A fourth angle in terms of looking at women in civil resistance is actually organized nonviolent struggles for women's rights and empowerment around the world. And this has been going on in the 19th century, the 20th century, and even in the 21st century. So we know about it going on, like we know about like the women's suffrage movement in our countries, and this has been happening in other countries, and then even in the 20th century and 21st century. So several years ago in Iran, the women's movement in Iran has been going on for many decades, but it really picked up again late 1990s and then into the first decade of the 21st century. So one of the most interesting and organized campaigns was the 1 million signature campaign in Iran. And this was really going. This was during the time of President Ahmadinejad. There was a huge crackdown on any dissent in Iran. And yet these women were like one of the key forces that were engaging in anything that we could call dissent in society, in the country at that time, that was nonviolent dissent. So when the Green Revolution started after fraudulent elections, then this movement joined the revolution, as you saw with the movement to defend Khimki Forest in Russia. The whole movement sort of joined this more broader pro-democracy movement. In Egypt, this happened with Shafin Qom, which then morphed into something called Egyptians Against Corruption. And then that joined into the January 25th revolution in Egypt. So you see, interestingly, these groups, these movements that are launched by women, either for women's rights or for broader rights, for other general rights in society, often then are very catalytic at critical points. They provide strength, numbers, and organization skills and tactical creativity. And then in Africa, some of you may be aware of the Green Belt Movement. Wangari Maathai is a Nobel Prize Peace Prize laureate, as was actually Lema Gambawi, the woman you saw in the clip from Liberia. She also won the Nobel Peace Prize. So again, isn't this an interesting juxtaposition that she was fighting, her and the Green Belt Movement were fighting for women's empowerment, sustainable development, and political corruption. So in real life, sometimes you can't really separate out things. You can't say, I'm just going to have a movement about women's rights, because it intersects other things in society. Or you can't have a movement about, for example, sustainable livelihood, because that is really intersecting with the capacity of women to survive. So you see, this is why it's very interesting to study these kinds of efforts that are in which women are playing very important roles, because they're very catalytic and they pull together different things in the society within the civil resistance efforts that they are involved in. So this is a chart. I'm not going to go through it. You'll have it in the PowerPoint, but it was done by Anne-Marie Kodur. And it sort of gives you sort of the different types of movements and the participation of women in civil resistance. And so you can sort of almost approach studying the phenomena through this slide. But then we have a question. So far, does anyone have a comment, question, experience that they've had that they want to share? So your question is, when there is a broader movement or campaign for something that's very broad objectives in the society, how do we then integrate these these very important elements grievances and inequalities into that movement? That's a really good question. I mean, that's actually something that I think would be very ripe for study. There was one reading that should be in what you were sent by Meta Spencer, that there's a paper that analyzes that with the Egyptian January 25th revolution. So it's a dilemma for women, for example. If women sort of join a movement, which is not exactly what you're saying, but when women and a women's civil resistance effort joins into a broader movement, usually then they have to like put that aside to like focus on the broader effort. So I would think, and that's where we would need research, is to look at how do you do, have there been cases where that did happen, where part of the broader vision and the broader objectives included things that were of importance and necessity for women as a group. And I've not seen any research like that. I don't know if others in the room might have come across any research or know of any cases in which that happened. My sense would be the more women that are involved in the leadership and in the strategizing and organizing, the better chance that that would happen. But again, that would be my assumption, just and so I don't have a like a clear answer. The lady here in yellow.
I've recently come back from two very interesting places, Burma or Myanmar, and North and South Korea. In the Burma instance, the story of Aung San Suu Kyi and her phenomenal leadership, and herself, I think, being inspired both by her, the example of her father to keep pushing for something, and her own awareness of the human rights, gross human rights violations within her country. So that kept her going and kept her at the wheel, where they, she has developed a political party. Mm-hmm. Now she has been elected to be the, whatever she's going to call herself, in the new government. And this, in the North and South Korea example, there's something very interesting that's just evolving. There were 30 women, international women, who visited North Korea and then in South Korea, walking, actually we couldn't walk, we had to bus through the demilitarized zone. But the objective there is reunification, ultimately, peace and reunification. So this, I think, is an example of women organizing, trying to make a difference in that long, long, intractable situation. I can fill you in a bit more because there have been some add-ons beyond what I experienced in May.
And was this something that was not, it was not only involving women from the countries, but also then international women? So you could almost call that a transnational organized effort. Yeah, so that's a very interesting example. So that it's not just limited to within the country, but women across borders who have to have a common vision and objective.
That was deliberately part of the strategy.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Thank you for that example. And
my name is Leanne McKenna. I do training in conflict transformation and third-party nonviolent intervention in war zones. And I've been working for the last few years in Northeast India, where unknown to most people, there have been about 600,000 people killed in internecine, apparently, conflict. And I was, in my first visit there, I asked for a usual sort of group of about 20, 24, half women, half men, a variety of different parties in the region. When I arrived, instead, there were 40 men, and from four or five different communities engaged in protracted conflict. And one of the main goals was to design peace commissions, community-based peace commissions, so they could intervene in conflict before they became turned into violence. And usually when I'm doing a training like this, we start out very early in doing something called a gender fishbowl, where women get to talk amongst themselves with men listening. And we ask two questions. What's the ideal woman in your culture? And basically, in some way, is this working for you? Anything wrong with this picture? And it is amazing what happens and what the men hear. Often, for the very first time, it has never occurred to them that women are anything but completely satisfied with their lot in life. So how do you do something like that in a group of just men? So we actually did it right towards the end of the training, after they'd gone through building the peace commissions and had assembled in their first attempt at it, headmen representing everybody and everything, and maybe the Naga Women's or Naga Mothers Association. And that was it. So we talked about the notion of free, prior, and informed consent. They understood that is one of the main, you know, sort of tools in their toolbox in terms of the loss of indigenous land in the Northeast. So I'll finish as quickly as possible. Right towards the end of the training, I decided, no, I'm going to go ahead, we're going to do a gender fishbowl. And I divided the room, 20 of the women, 20 of the men. The 20 who were women, men, some of them put on hijabs and so on, sat in the middle of the circle, and I facilitated this conversation. Same questions. What is the ideal woman in your culture? Is there anything wrong with this picture? Unbelievably, they channeled remarkably accurately what I've heard in so many other situations around the world, what women would say. It sucks. I hate it. All the men make all the decisions about our lives and our communities and my children and so on, while I'm doing this and this and this and this and this. They're sitting in the center square drinking tea and making decisions about our lives. And it was astonishing. And one of the pictures I have in the days just following that is these 40 men, and they're doing the ankle walk, an exercise of cooperation. And these men have been killing one another, and they all have their arms around one another. It's just an astonishing piece of work. And they then went on to create peace commissions, half women, half men, mm-hmm. and a quarter of them were youth, and so on. It's astonishing.
Thanks for that example. So it shows that, in fact, that when you were, when people are trying to organize themselves, whether in a peace commission or in a nonviolent campaign or movement or whatever, that one can be proactive in thinking about, input and roles for women and men. And that one doesn't have to just assume that things will just happen on their own. And so it's a good example to think about, even in leadership circles and movements, how can this proactively be addressed within a leadership movement to make sure that women's views and input and gifts and needs are integrated as part of something that's very broad. Thank you for that. Yes, the person in the back.
I was just wondering, do you really think that these like broad movements where the term is just women like is the best way to do things? I've been doing a lot of research and looking into anti-essentialism, and it's pretty much saying within these groups there still ends up being like a hierarchy. And for example, you mentioned the suffragette movement, and in that originally like the white woman in Canada, they literally just told the woman of color, all right, get out of here, we use you as a platform, and they gain the right to vote first. And do you not think that that can happen if we don't learn from those mistakes?
Yeah, it can happen, yeah. I mean, yeah, sure, it could happen, yeah. Even women can lack sensitivity about other sources of discrimination, for example, race or religion or things like that, yeah. So this is like something that's really important, what's important inherently, but also if you look at it from a strategic standpoint for the strength, resilience, and capacity of a movement, that's not really a good idea. And even if you look at women's movements, for example, women's movements often will very strategically think about why do we need to, or why is it necessary to involve men, for example. And that's the same thing with any group that is like marginalized in a society. So also with minority groups and the civil rights movement too. It's like, why do we need to engage with the majority white population? Even in a place like, believe it or not, an anti-occupation struggle. If we are, for example, in East Timor, which was part of Indonesia, the struggle that once it moved from armed struggle to unarmed, to nonviolent struggle, there was a concerted, deliberate effort on the part of young people, students, to reach out to their Indonesian counterparts, to involve them, to get their support for their struggle for independence. So these are all like important dynamics, both for moral reasons and for strategic reasons.
Thanks for that.
Oh, Hamid.
So if we think about gender, then gender is not the same as thinking about women in civil resistance. And I remember when I first encountered this, this was a few years ago, this is also reflecting an evolution in our thinking. I had trouble wrapping my mind about the difference between looking at women and thinking about gender. So I liked this definition from the International Committee of the Red Cross of all places. But it was simple and it sort of got to the point. So what is gender? These are the culturally expected behaviors of women and men that are based on the roles, the attitudes, and values that are ascribed to them on the basis of their sex, where sex refers to your biological and physical characteristics. So biological means your like DNA, and physical means your physical appearance, your external appearance. So it's a little different from your actual like biological who you are as XX or XY, and some people are actually born in between that, very small minority of people. So my question is then, are gender roles and gender attitudes and gender-based values fixed in stone, immutable, never changeable? Or are these things that change? Yes, the gentleman up here, yes.
Man, there was a presentation on campus last Thursday called How Women Need to Protect Men. And it was about the role women have in the upbringing of men, and in, you know, what is the women's role in taking care of men in society. And I think that's a perfect example of how in modern times, you know, the definitions of what a protector is and all that is becoming less and less clear. Now, you know, we're all kind of figuring this out. So I would say definitely gender roles are changing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a very good example. Very good example. And even looking at all of you here today, I mean, looking at some of you who are coming from the military colleges, there are women coming from the military colleges, there are women soldiers. And that's something that's not traditional according to gender roles. So things change all the time. And so even what we wear changes. So, you know, what does it mean to dress like a woman or a man? Well, if you live in Myanmar, everybody wears a skirt, right? The difference is how you tie it. So the men tie it like this and the women tie it like that. But everybody's in a skirt. But, you know, in North America, do we see too many men wearing skirts? Maybe Scottish men who are, you know, playing the bagpipes, but otherwise, no. So all of these things are like, you know, what we consider as part of like being male or female are real. A lot of that has to do with like cultural behaviors, attitudes, and norms and things like that. And so that's the difference. So when we want to look at gender and civil resistance, we want to look at that interplay of these notions, these attitudes and roles and values that we ascribe to men and women in a particular context. And how does that impact their participation and their roles in civil resistance? So we can do, for example, gender analysis. And this comes from two scholars, Deanne Mazzarana and Keith Proctor. And so a gender analysis, for people who want to do a gender analysis of civil resistance, will look at an issue or a particular struggle through the lens of gender. So that would include the identities and behavior and realities of women and men, the power distribution and power relationships between them, and how that affects participation and leadership and decisions in civil resistance. We can look at how gender roles and relations organize authority, rights and responsibilities, access to resources and life options along the lines that demarcate men and women in a particular society, because again, that varies society by society. So that could be like, for example, the intersection with land rights. So in countries like Cambodia or Sierra Leone, or I'll just give you the example of Sierra Leone, women may not have official property rights. A lot of women in rural areas, but they have
oh, I'm forgetting the term now. They have traditional rights. So they have claim to the land, but they may not have a paper for it. So what can happen is that it's easier for them to be displaced, either from relatives who want to take their land, or from officials who want to like just expropriate a lot of land and sell it or lease it for like agricultural production to companies that come from other countries. So they're very vulnerable. So there's that intersection with gender and their realities, their capacity to survive, and then the reason why they are in the vanguard of struggles for land rights. Does that make sense to people? So I was looking for the term customary. So women may have customary ownership of land, but they may not have official ownership. And that's what makes them vulnerable as women in that society. Another aspect of gender analysis and nonviolent resistance is how does it inform our understanding of the phenomena of nonviolent resistance? And how does gender analysis deepen our understanding of the dynamics and practice of it? So one thing is to study civil resistance as a phenomena, where it's occurring, why, what happened, etc. Another way to look at it is the dynamics. What was going on? What was happening? Was there a lot of disruption? Were there some shifts of positions? Were there some defections? Were there some massive, like you could call the power of people, the power of numbers? That's something that Erica Chenoweth and Maria Stefan found from their research that unity, all of these things we're talking about, brings in people, and you need a lot of people in nonviolent resistance relative to your struggle context. So how does gender analysis deepen our understanding of these two elements of civil resistance? And then if you want to look at a particular struggle, for example, how do many women participate in a given nonviolent movement or campaign? For example, were particular roles in the movement or campaign restricted to women? Or were particular roles in a campaign assumed by women? And were some roles in a campaign restricted to men because of gender roles? And were particular roles assumed by men because of the gender roles in that particular society? So these are interesting things to study, because we can learn more about civil resistance and skills and strategies and the phenomena by taking a gender analysis. So I want to give you some examples of that instead of just talking about it in the abstract. Oh, okay. So I will give you some examples in a minute. Another question is something that is coming up in the literature a little bit, which is, does the presence of women in the leadership of a nonviolent movement or during nonviolent street actions help keep nonviolent discipline? Because in many societies, maybe most societies in the world, women are perceived as being naturally less violent. Now, I'm not saying that's true, but I'm saying that's the perception that goes around gender roles. So it would be interesting to see, if you have more women in leadership, is it easier to keep nonviolent discipline? Or if you have more women in the street actions, where there's a high risk for violence to erupt, does that help maintain nonviolent discipline? I don't have the answer. But I think it would be very useful to know that. And we'll never have a clear answer, but it will be useful to have cases. And then it goes back to the point that Sandra raised earlier. Are women and objectives and demands incorporated into a struggle? That would be a gender analysis. Because you're not looking for, you want to look to see how that the gender dimension, the fact that they're women's demands versus what are perceived as general demands, are they valued as much and incorporated into the struggle? And are women's demands influenced by gender roles? So, for example, like if there's a movement and there are certain demands, are these arising out of, and women are making certain demands, are these arising out of their gender roles, for example, as mothers, as daughters, as sisters,
et cetera, as nurturers. And you could say that, for example, the Liberian clip that I showed you, that in a way, their demands were influenced because they did see themselves as the mothers of the country. And they saw themselves as nurturers. Of course, they also rejected the war, the civil war that was going on, for many other reasons. But there was a little bit of a gender dimension to that, too. One could say, why wasn't it that women, that men didn't get together and say, we need to stop the civil war? Why was it women? Because women sort of saw this differently, that it was like hurting the country, and they felt that they were the mothers, and they needed to protect and save the country. Yes?
Do you find in your research that after a movement which is led by women, that their roles actually do shift or evolve or change, or do they revert back to what they were before the movement?
That's a good question. I've not found any research that's looked at that in any way. So again, this is like ripe. It's a very ripe question to look into, and probably be like a qualitative study to look at different things. The closest that I could find, that I could refer to, is this reading you have on Egypt. And the women were not the leaders of the movement, but the women, there were very key women in the nonviolent uprising, especially amongst the youth groups. And I think that based on that paper, that they would say that they were sidelined after. It happened in Tunisia too, but the women in Tunisia got really mobilized. And they fought after the Tunisian revolution to make sure that in the new constitution and in the new laws that equality and issues that were important for women were enshrined in the new sort of legislative framework for the country. Did you? Someone else? No. Okay. There's another interesting element to this too, and it's a gender element, which is, are women able to open civic space and express dissent in ways that are not available to men based on gender norms and values? What do you think?
Yes.
Do you have any examples that come to mind, or? Yes.
I'm thinking of the Mothers of Soldiers, the Committee of Mothers of Soldiers in Russia, where during the First Chechen War, they organized a march all the way down. Of course, they were protecting their sons. If the sons would, go AWOL, they would hide them and take them in and so on. But they undertook a march all the way down to Chechnya. And they said, you guys have got to come home. We're your mothers, and we say, stop this war and come home with us. And some of them did, including one colonel, who went home with his mother. I don't think if his father had come, he would have done it.
That's a very interesting example, yeah, of the gender dimension to that, yeah. Exactly. So they were very clever that way. I mean, they also wanted their sons to come back. I mean, that was clear. That was one of their objectives. But they didn't do it, they didn't make that claim on the basis of, like, for example, the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights or the Geneva Convention of Warfare or anything else. Their reason was very clear. We're your mothers and we want you home. That's it. Yes? Yes.
The story that comes immediately to mind is one Jean Sharp made famous. It took place in Berlin and the, it was the, German women who had Jewish husbands, their husbands had been rounded up, and they staged a protest, and government immediately released all these men. They were just shocked that women would stage a public protest in, Berlin.
Mm-hmm. That's a very good example too, yeah. These were Christian women married to Jewish men. And the men had already been taken away, and they started, doing like very low-key but clear demand, public, that they wanted their husbands back. And not only did they succeed, which was shocking, but they also got safe passage so that they could leave together
and get out of Germany, Nazi Germany at the time.
So that was called the Women of Rosenstrasse. And there's an excellent chapter in a book called Courageous Resistance by Sharon Scheffela. If you Google Sharon Scheffela and just Google Courageous, you'll find the book. And there's a chapter by a historian named Nathan Stoltzfus, who's like probably the leading expert on this that I know. You can just read about it, because he goes into a lot of detail and how this created a huge dilemma for the Nazi regime. And they didn't know what to do with these women. I mean, they were really making calculations, because under Nazi propaganda, a wife and a mother were the most important roles that any woman could have. So if you attacked a woman who was supporting her husband and being a good wife, you're going against your own propaganda about the importance of women supporting their husbands and being good wives. So it's a very interesting dynamic. Can women use, and oh, sorry, there was a lady here, and then a gentleman there, yes.
An example that comes to mind is in John Paul Lederach's book, Moral Imagination. He talks about women of Wajir in Kenya who they were experiencing conflict locally, and it was a male-female dynamic, but basically in the marketplace, they basically controlled it because they were working in the markets and selling their products and stuff. So when they saw conflict arise, they decided that instead of acting violently, that they would just come together and talk about it, and then if they would hear that something's happening on one end of the market, they would then send someone to dispute that conflict and resolve it. And it ended up being really powerful, and even though it was grassroots, it built on itself, and they talked to, you know, their elders, and they had connections to the government structure, and then eventually, I mean, peace wasn't totally resolved, or conflict wasn't totally resolved in the area, but it led to, like, peace accords and different things that were going on, so.
So another good example of grassroots mobilizing an organization, would you, I'm not familiar with the case, so would you say that was an example of like nonviolent action or nonviolent resistance?
Yeah. Instead of fighting back or getting angry about it, they just came together and talked about it and used communication, mm-hmm. and the men respected the women in this aspect of their mm-hmm. society. So
what was it called?
The book.
Yeah.
It was Moral Imagination by
Moral
Imagination.
Okay.
By John Paul Lederach. Pretty sure it's in that book, but Lederach's definitely the author.
Okay. So, thank you for that example. There was one more person who had an example. Yes.
Yeah, just real quick, the example that came to mind for me is coming from a military context, but mm-hmm. the principle remains the same, I imagine, for nonviolent tactics as well. Since the integration of women into the military, and especially into what we call the combat arms trade, so the pointy end, infantry, armor, etc., we've been able to bridge communication barriers that aren't necessarily just linguistic. Mm-hmm. In many countries, even if we have interpreters, they can speak the local language because of gender roles, and the mesh not only of gender roles, but of gender roles within culture and religious context, even if we have people who speak the language, women, who are arguably half the local population, won't necessarily speak to male soldiers, but they'll speak to female soldiers, and for that matter, they'll also allow medical treatment and all kinds of other interactions to take place because we have women in our ranks. So it mm-hmm. it broadens that degree of cooperation, and it is a military setting, but the principle is the same. We can interact with more people and try to do more good. So, and that's mm-hmm. directly because of the roles of women in various cultures around the world. Mm-hmm.
So, in a way, I mean, yeah. There, so, given gender roles, it's easier in some societies for women to interact with other women, and also they may feel less threatened, which that can sort of probably have, I mean, across a lot of societies. So again, it brings into this whole thing about when you have, I mean, that women can bring things into, well, in your case, it's an institution, but it can be into a nonviolent movement, bring things in that can then lead, again, as you said, make people comfortable, reduce the sense of feeling threatened, or and involve people in some sort of an engagement, engage people. So it's a dynamic, your example is a dynamic that cuts across different kinds of things in a society. So it's not just limited to nonviolent campaigns and movements. Thanks for that example. One last one. Lots of people have good, let me see how many slides I have left. Okay, I just have four slides, so let's have to continue the discussion. So everybody has a chance to give an example. So the gentleman in the back, then who else? Here, one, two, three, four, and then we cut to one. Oh, five, okay, all right, yes.
I'll be quick. Building off what he said, the American military had the same lesson learned while we are in the Middle East. We call them civilian engagement teams, and we integrated women into them, and it makes them much more effective. There's an old saying, if you want to know what an Arab's thinking, talk to his wife. But, you know, a male cannot talk to a female, so we had to integrate women as well. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, it took us way, way too long to figure that out. Military intelligence is a contradiction, as the saying goes, but... yeah, that's completely 100% one of the critical changes that are improving
campaigns. So another example of gender roles, you could say opening up space for engagement in that context. Yeah, interesting. So we're seeing examples that are cutting across different institutions and phenomena. So yes.
In our country, we've had a number of instances lately, both in the military and the RCMP, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, reports of pervasive sexual assaults and sexism in general. And just in the last few days, there was a report, I think it was the one dealing with the RCMP, that said they need to hire more women in order to socialize the men. And so to me, that is, In the essentialist constructivist discussion, I would place myself smack in the middle. And I think that this ruling is one of those that supports that, you know, we're a bit of both. We are constructed, but there are also elements of us that are clearly essential.
Mm-hmm. That's an interesting thing, how you have the interplay of women and gender, gender roles for men, and gender roles for women. Mm-hmm. And then we'll look at sort of like what women do and what men do. Mm-hmm. That's it. Yeah. Thank you for that example. Our lady in the back. Yeah.
So I was thinking of the women in Liberia.
Yeah.
Who organized Christian and Muslim women together. Because they were just sick and tired of seeing all the violence in the civil war in Liberia. Mm-hmm. So they, at the end, scene that really stuck with me, and I have to say, I'm not sure why the women weren't inside with the men negotiating, but the men were negotiating, it was taking them way too long, they were just not getting agreement. So the women surrounded the building and they would have let them out, they blocked all the doors, said, you're not coming out, you know, you're not getting food, you're not getting whatever, you've got to come to an agreement. That was just one of the tactics they used, but they were just determined that it was going to happen. I was thinking of them, I was also thinking of Green in Common, you know, women's encampment mm-hmm. that over 10 years successfully demilitarized that and brought back to common ground mm-hmm. land that was being used by the military there.
That's in the UK, correct?
The UK.
Yeah. I believe that one of the readings that we offered for this session is actually also does discuss this, the Green in Common. So there are lots of good resources for people if they want to like tap into this from the list that you got from us.
Film about the women in Liberia.
Yeah, pray the devil back to hell.
Yes,
that's it. So
There's an example of an intersection of gender and women and nonviolent resistance. Because you said that their focus was to get those warring parties that were having a blast in a 5-star hotel in Ghana to actually come to a negotiated agreement. That was their demand. But look at the difference. I mean, there you can see maybe a gender analysis dimension to this. Their demand was not that they have a seat at the table. Their demand was, you guys get to an agreement. Now, these women were, some of them, the leaders were very educated, professional women. But you could see maybe there was a gender dimension to this. I don't know. If I ever got to meet one of them, I would ask them, why was that your demand, and why did you want to also demand to have a seat at the table? Because you were part of a women's movement. I mean, there were thousands of women with you. You had just as much a right to be there as these, you know, as the dictator Charles Taylor and the paramilitary guerrilla groups. One more person had her hand up. Yes. Oh, two people. Yes. Yeah, sorry. So this lady and then you. Sorry about that. Yes.
I was just picture.
Let's start from here.
The grandmothers from Argentina. The Plaza de Mayo, I think it was called, but like that was kind of also anti-corruption as well, because they were like lobbying to have their children returned back to them after the disappearance.
Thank you. Look, what a brilliant segue! I didn't know she was going to say that. Honestly, goodness. And there's the photo.
Yeah,
so thank you. We're on the same wavelength. Yeah. Very good example. Thank you. And I'll mention something about it. Do you want to say anything else about it?
No, I was just gonna, it's just a great example.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. And last but not least, okay.
I was just going to comment on the clip you showed us from the film Butrix.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't think the woman who was in the army would have taken it with as much humor if the women protesting were actually men.
Exactly, yes.
Offering, like, you can marry my son, or I'll give you lots of sheep, things like that. She took it, she thought it was kind of funny.
So, right.
Yeah, it would be different. It would be a different context if it was men.
Yeah. Very good point. So there you see women as protagonists, women on the side for, you know, the side that's, you know, the other side that in a military role. So women who are facing each other, both are stepping out of their gender roles. Huh? Because the Israeli soldier, all women have to go through the military in Israel. So that is not exactly part of their gender role, but it doesn't mean that. But also Israeli women are also, as you saw the photo of the interview of her afterwards, she was she looked like any woman who liked to wear makeup and all this other stuff. So she still, there were gender roles that she had. And so, and one gender role was to feel a solidarity. I mean, maybe that's a woman to woman thing, I don't know, but to feel a solidarity or some connection with women. So, and on the Palestinian side, you had these young women stepping out of their gender roles and being in the forefront and doing all these brave things, right? So they were both, in a way, assuming their gender roles, but at the same time doing things that were not a part of their gender roles. And then you saw that very interesting interaction that was not hostile. So, one more person? No, that's it. You basically helped me get to this whole question then. Are they able to use their gender roles, example as mothers, sisters, grandmothers, nurturers, to challenge abuse and injustice? And you basically give an answer, yes. My question then is, does this give them legitimacy? That's another aspect of a gender analysis. When women use gender roles to make their demands, does that increase their legitimacy as actors, as leaders, as protagonists, or and does that increase the legitimacy of their demands? I don't have an answer. But that's an interesting thing to look at. And I think in the examples you gave, you basically did give examples where women did have that authority and legitimacy that they used based on their gender roles. So for example, the mothers of the disappeared in Argentina. The military regime in Argentina was extremely brutal. People were disappeared. Are you all familiar with that term, to be disappeared?
Yes.
Okay. children were taken from their parents, if children were born in jail, or even children, as far as I've read, sometimes people who were deemed enemies of the state had their children taken from them, their babies, and then they were given up for adoption to families in the military regime who wanted to adopt children. So women used their roles as mothers and grandmothers, and they also wanted to find out what happened to their children. That was their objective. They didn't go into this part, this playa, this central plaza, not a plaza in the shopping sense, but a place where we gather. And they didn't go there and say, we want the end of the dictatorship. They just said, we want to know what happened to our children. And the regime at first didn't know what to do. First they laughed at them, they tried to discredit them, they called them the las locas, the crazy ones. But then the women kept coming, and then some more women were joining, and they got themselves organized. They started organizing and doing all the things we talked about in the nonviolent campaign. Then that created a dilemma for the regime. How should they crack down on them? They didn't like it because they were expressing dissent. But to crack down on mothers wanting to know what happened to their children, that's like a red line, even for that really brutal dictatorship to cross. So they did crack down, but then that didn't work either. So that backfired. So again, women can and have used their gender roles to challenge abuse and injustice. And it does actually, in the example I gave you and in many other examples, it does create dilemmas for oppressor repression. For example, in the women of the Rosenstrasse Street in Berlin during World War II, the Nazi regime had a huge dilemma about what to do with them. And the women in the example you gave, Meta, from Russia, I mean, what would the Russian authorities do? Like, arrest the women, the mothers, who were just like, I mean, actually, they were just being their mothers. They were being good mothers to care about their children, their boys. And then I'm just going to move along to the end. So do women, another aspect of gender analysis, just think about it, do women have particular opportunities to cooperate and mobilize not available to men in their society? You saw that from Liberia. Some of the examples that were given actually point to that, that in fact, women do have things available to them that are not available to men. On the other hand, men have things available to them because of gender roles that may not be available to women in a given society. So if you go back to this whole idea at the very beginning of yesterday, which is numbers and participation, that's why we need everybody. That's how, I mean, civil resistance isn't something with just a few people. We need lots of people, and that definitely includes women. And then finally, another question, what strategic advantages can the participation of women bring to a struggle? So for example, and this is a gender analysis, because you could also ask the same about men. What strategic advantages, based on gender roles, can men bring to a struggle? And if we are, for example, studying nonviolent resistance movement, or if we are in one, and we are strategizers and organizers, wouldn't it be helpful to think about this? If we want to be effective researchers or effective strategists? And finally, and this is a very important question, do women experience particular forms of oppression and violence that men may not when they are engaged in nonviolent resistance? That's something very important. I have not come across any research about it, but that certainly would be something important to ask. If people are researching a movement, that would be something important to ask the women that they meet. Yes?
All of the UN research on women and conflict, mm-hmm. on gender-based sexual violence and war, there's a lot of research and material on
agreed.
Violence, yeah.
Yes, I agree. So yes, in terms of conflict, there's a lot of research, yes. And there are deliberate acts of violence that are done deliberately to women in war as an act of violence, like mass rape.
As a strategy of war,
exactly. My question for this would be, for women who are engaged in nonviolent resistance, do they face any types of violence or repression based on the fact that they're women? I don't know. And I mean, they may, and you know,
Well, I can say that for, I mean, it could be like, they may face certain types of sexual violence by authorities that men may not face to such a large degree. But it would certainly be something important to research. Yes, and then I'm gonna go to the last point and we're done. Yes, and then, yeah. No, okay, I'll go to the last point and then you will have the last word, okay? And then the last question I think that would be important to research to look into is, do women experience social or personal repercussions for engaging in nonviolent resistance that men may not face? So these are often societal repercussions or personal repercussions. So for example, I threats to lose their children or divorcee, that's a title. So I know, for example, in Cambodia, a woman leader of a land rights struggle, Bopa Yorm, ended up getting a divorce from her husband. Because she was also jailed for 381 days. She had a 10-year-old boy at the time. But in the end, she got a divorce. She didn't like tell me all about it, but basically it was like this. Her nonviolent resistance, her leadership, and certainly, of course, the jail, all of this created such big rifts in the marriage that it ended in divorce. Evgenia Krikova had, in Russia, there was a legal effort to take her children away from her, which she fought and successfully. And in the end, one of the reasons that she fled to Estonia was because she felt that they were going to, this time, again, attempt to take her children away from her, and this time they were going to do it. So in the first attempt, there were false witnesses who claimed she was abusing her children. And then when she pressed this, she went to court and everything, these witnesses didn't even exist. So she won her case. But then with the second time, she could see the writing was on the wall, and she said, I'm not going to let them take my children. I'm getting out of here. She didn't care what could happen to her so much, but that worried her. We're getting to the end.
I could just add a point about the name of Malawi.
Mm-hmm.
She told me when we were on the trip to North and South Korea that her personal security now in Liberia is very compromised.
Mm-hmm.
She's building a retreat kind of place that will be heavily guarded. That's the cost for her.
Why, and is this because of people who are loyal either to the paramilitary groups or the former regime that are like want to get revenge, or you know?
I think it relates to tensions between the possibility of Ellen serving
Johnson,
Johnson being reelected, and competition. Competition is seen as coming from Lima. So I don't know how those political camps
That's a very good example too. I was aware of that. Well, I thank you for your interest and contributions. I think that this was something that was touched a lot of people, and I get the sense that it sort of piqued a lot of interest. So I hope that I've inspired people to sort of be aware of these dynamics and also hopefully to want to research and study these dynamics. Thank you.